Hello and welcome to this presentation of FLOW-3D Hydro. FLOW-3D Hydro was just released recently, October 29th. Delighted to be able to be with you today and give you an overview of what this new software is all about. So FLOW-3D Hydro, the complete CFD solution for water infrastructure and environmental engineering. So welcome everyone. A lot of people in the audience today from all over the world. Warm welcome. And of course, as usual, all registrants will be emailed a link to download the slides and the recording. So thank you for registering. Any questions, please email us at hydro@flow3d.com. That'll be the bottom left of your screen for the entire presentation. Okay, so a couple of announcements. We are hoping that we can all travel safely next summer, and if that's the case, we will be hosting our World User Conference in Munich, June 7th and 9th in Germany. Call for abstracts is open. If you would like to send us some abstracts and share with us the kind of work you've been doing, we'd love to hear from you. You can visit flow3d.com /WUC2021. And we also really like to be able to connect with you. You can follow us on LinkedIn, you can follow the company page. Anytime, feel free to connect with myself, John Wendelbow, my colleague Brian Fox, or in fact anyone at Flow Science. We're always happy to connect with fellow engineers, modelers, developers. It's always interesting to see what kind of work you do, and we can also use this to share the kind of the new materials and the work that we do. So please get connected. Okay, so Flow-3D Hydro V1, this is V1.0, the first release. What are we going to talk about today? We'll talk about, well, we'll give you a brief introduction. Not everyone in the audience is necessarily completely familiar with Flow Science. And then, so that will be a brief introduction. And then, what is Flow-3D Hydro? Computational fluid dynamics for the water, civil and environmental practice. Flow-3D Hydro modeling capabilities. And then a big focus of Hydro is the user interface, effective, accurate, and error-free modeling. So we'll talk about that, and in particular, the use of templates, examples, and video tutorials. So that will be part of our presentation today. Of course, any questions, still, please email us at hydro@flow3d.com, or also, in fact, maybe better, is for you to find your local associate, local Flow Science representative. We have offices all over the world, and the easiest way to find your kind of immediate local connection is to go to flow3d.com global and look up who's around in your neck of the woods, and you will be able to get probably answers a lot faster than emailing us here in our headquarters in the US. So if you are in the US and Canada, well, please email us at hydro@flow3d.com. Before I forget, I wanted to mention workshops. So we do workshops all over the world, and these workshops are really an excellent way to get introduced to modeling with Flow-3D Hydro. So we have some workshops scheduled in India, in the UK and Ireland, in Latin America. Flow3d.co stands for Colombia. Flow3d.com is for the US. And Flow-3D in Australasia also has already scheduled a whole series of workshops, and it's entirely possible that I've forgotten some of our local associates. Please visit your local associates and see if they have any workshops you can attend, or if not, maybe you can also just request a workshop. Why not? So different dates in India. We have some workshops scheduled every month, some workshops also coming up in the UK, in Latin America, and in our case in the US also, workshops for the rest of 2021, and then also in Australia. So a very busy year for everyone, and a lot of opportunities to learn and discover what Flow 3D Hydro is all about. Okay, so again, where to find us? Flow3D.com global, and you should be able to find someone you can talk to in your time zone. Okay, so a little bit about flow science. We have our origins, I suppose, go back to the Los Alamos National Laboratory in New Mexico, and some of the early days of computational fluid dynamics with the Mark and Cell method, one of the methods used for arbitrary free surfaces, and then importantly the development of the volume of fluid method, which is a seminal method, a very, very good method for tracking free surface flows. So that was developed during that time, and in 1980 Flow Science was founded as a commercial engineering software development company, and then the first release of Flow 3D V1.0 was in 1985, and then since then of course hardware has evolved, software has evolved, and today we have a very, very sophisticated solution for free surface flows. International presence today, and our headquarters are in Santa Fe now, New Mexico, where we have the bulk of our developers and staff. Okay, so that's just a little bit of history for flow science. So at the core, before Flow 3D Hydro ever existed, we had Flow 3D, which is a multi-physics CFD tool, computational fluid dynamics. And this kind of is the result of 40 years of developing a general purpose CFD solver. That's Flow 3D. Flow 3D is an industry leading 3D free surface solver, which deploys a technology called TrueVOF, which is a version of VOF that we've refined over the years and is now proprietary to Flow Science. Broad range of integrated multiphysics, and we have a user interface, of course. So this is a commercial tool, so we have to be able to help the user quickly find solutions to their problems. Advanced post-processing is essential in order to look at results, of course. And then with, you know, the developments of new hardware, clusters, cloud computing, etc., of course, the solution needs to be fully parallelized for fast, efficient simulations. And so today we have a kind of completely seamless performance integration from the laptop solution all the way to high performance cluster-based and cloud-based solutions. This means that we operate in a good number of applications anywhere where free surfaces are important. So that includes metal casting, consumer products, all sorts of things. And really the net result is that over time, it's been desirable to split things up a little bit. Sometimes, for instance, if you think about metal casting, there are a lot of functionalities and very application-specific details which are really unique to metal casting. And even within metal casting, a whole bunch of different applications within that field of simulation. So it made sense to develop a tool which uses the Flow 3D engine solver, but really responds to the needs of the metal casting practice. So that was Flow 3D Cast. More recently, we've also been doing a lot of work with additive manufacturing. That's what AM stands for, Flow 3D AM Weld. So in this case also, it's a very particular kind of application, and it doesn't really fit in the context of a multi-physics solver. So we have an AM Weld solution. Of course, for genuinely multi-physics problems, and until now for a long time also for water problems, we use Flow 3D, but now it made sense to develop a version of Flow 3D specifically for water, so that we could best serve the engineering practice, and that is Flow 3D Hydro. So Flow 3D Hydro is one of the products based on the Flow 3D solver that is specifically catered to the needs of the civil engineering practice. So a few statements here, I'm just going to read them. Flow 3D Hydro is a computational fluid dynamics CFD, modeling solution designed specifically for the water, civil and environmental engineering industry. Okay, that's what the mission is here. And what we do is we deploy a powerful solver developed specifically for free surface flows. That's the FLOW-3D engine. And FLOW-3D Hydro includes user interface functionalities and physics models geared towards the needs of the water civil practice. All right. And what we are trying to do here, in all cases, is to deliver an accurate three-dimensional representation of the flow and how it interacts with the built or natural environment. Okay, so that's all under the umbrella of what is FLOW-3D Hydro and computational fluid dynamics, question mark. So one maybe aspect that's worth mentioning here is that also FLOW-3D Hydro is truly a commitment to the industry that flow science intends to continue developing first-class modeling solutions for water and environmental applications. That's also an important statement which I wanted to make at this point. Okay, so let's think about this a little bit. Computational fluid dynamics, well, why use it in the first place? It's worth thinking about this just for a second before we move on to exactly what FLOW-3D Hydro is all about. But why use CFD? Well, it's because by and large, it can provide superior modeling accuracy over other methods. So given that superior accuracy, this becomes an additional piece of information, additional basis for the design of structures or for remedial decisions when something's not working and we're trying to figure out why. So CFD provides insights into why the fluid is behaving a certain way, and it provides insights into how a fluid is going to behave under operating or hypothetical conditions. That's the whole beauty of CFD, is that you can kind of span different iterations. And it's important to note that CFD is highly complementary with other tools and practices, whether it's lab work or other methods, other solutions. All of this is very complementary. It's just giving you additional information, different ways to look at one particular problem. So that's really why we use CFD in the first place. So we always want to create this kind of representation of the real world into our CFD model. So this is a nice example from Mott MacDonald, which was presented a couple of years ago at the European User Conference in 2018, I think. Just to give you an idea of what we're trying to do here, here's an example of a project with Wade Trim and IHHR in Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District, where we are looking at a drop shaft structure. And you see we have the lab image, the videotape on the left, and then on the right there we have the actual CFD simulation. And there's a whole presentation on this particular project. It's really remarkable how close the CFD representation gets to compared to the lab data. Okay, so another example here of a this is a sewer transition, looking at a hydraulic jump, and you can see the benefit of using a tool like FLOW-3D, 1.3% relative error over 32.3 using a different method. So really what CFD can do is provide just remarkable accuracy, and in fact with modern workstations and access to truly powerful computational resources, I should say widespread access to powerful computational resources these days, then CFD can now reach accuracy that match experimental uncertainty for a wide range of applications. So not for every application, but truly for a wide range of specifically for straight hydraulics, really CFD is now in a very good place in terms of robustness and accuracy. Okay, so some of the common modeling strategies that we face with free surface problems. Well, one of them, the most common for FLOW-3D users, FLOW-3D Hydro users, is the one fluid, volume of fluid, TruVOF method. Alternatively, you can use a two fluid solution, and I'm going to explain what this means in just a little bit. But in all cases, what happens is that beyond the hydraulics, you still have access if you need to additional physics. So it could be aerated flow, could be sediment and scour, could be thermal plumes, tailings, chemistry. So there's a whole range of auxiliary models which are available to Hydro users, which complements the solution to just, let's say, what the water is doing. So it can be water, but it can also be including, you know, chemical reactions and so on. So all of these are built on the hydraulic solution. And that hydraulic solution, I would say probably 90% of the time for civil applications, is what we call a one fluid VOF. And occasionally you'll use a two fluid VOF, in which case you're actually computing what's happening on the air side. And I'll show you what this looks like right now, actually. So on the left, we have a tangential drop shaft, just a kind of a portion of a tangential drop shaft. And what you're seeing there is just a one fluid VOF solution, which means we are only really computing what's happening to the water itself. And what you're seeing there in pink is the air, the core that's inside the water. So it's the core of this drop shaft, which is fine, but we have no real knowledge of what's going on in there. So sometimes that's fine. In most cases, that's fine. Tangential drop shafts are actually one case where you might actually be interested in knowing the full velocity field, not only on the water side, but also on the air side. So in that case, you would use what we call a two-fluid solution. And what you see there is on the left, in the middle portion there, we still have the water solution, which is basically exactly the same as what you see on the far left. But also on the far right, we also have the velocity field of what's happening inside that aerated core. So there's more information with a two-fluid solution. Having said that, in civil applications generally, except for certain cases like this one, no one cares what's happening on the air side, and there's just no reason to go calculate things on the air side. So something I just wanted to kind of point out when we talk about one fluid and two fluid solutions. In almost all cases, one fluid is really what we use. And the reason is, first of all, it's extremely accurate in terms of free surface solution, much simpler to model in terms of setup, and it's also significantly faster to run. So a lot of advantages in using one fluid true VOF over the two-fluid solution. And if you think, you know, of a weir, for instance, and you're just looking for the discharge, there's just no reason to calculate the, let's say, pressure and velocity field on the air side, okay? All right, so a lot of our users, historically, are FLOW-3D users in the water industry, and now there's an option to switch to FLOW-3D Hydro. So it's important to just point out the current FLOW-3D modeling capabilities for civil engineering applications are entirely preserved and available in FLOW-3D Hydro. FLOW-3D Hydro is not kind of a lesser version of FLOW-3D. It's truly something that is different and is going to continue focusing entirely on serving the needs of the civil engineering industry, whereas FLOW-3D's core mission is to focus on multiphysics as a whole. So they're two different things. Of course, there's a lot of similarity today, but over time you can expect Hydro really to focus on the needs specifically of civil engineers. So anyone working with water, it's probably a good idea to start thinking about migrating to Hydro. So we're not taking everything away, and it's also important to know that Hydro, today's Hydro, reads current FLOW-3D simulation files. So all of the work that you might have done in the past is completely safe in terms of revisiting those simulations. Not a problem. All of that can be loaded into Hydro. Okay? So just something I wanted to mention. And then generally, just for V1.0, in contrast to kind of what's coming in the future, V1.0 builds on industry leading modeling capabilities, yes, but what we focused on V1.0 is improving the user experience. That's been the focus of 1.0. And so faster model setup, convenient defaults, help and guidance where you need it and when you need it, fewer options to make mistakes, and collectively, what this adds up to is an improved modeling workflow and automatically almost improved modeling outcomes. So that's by and large the focus of V1. If we think about V2, so what, you know, we can expect to see about a year from now, what we are thinking there is to continue working on water treatment models and functionalities. That's a big focus for us in 2021. And then also another big focus is shallow water modeling and functionalities and things like GIS integration and so on. So those are kind of what we're looking at in terms of the kind of immediate future developments for V2.0 following V1.0. So river environmental and water treatment, kind of two areas where we hope to make progress and have something for you about a year from now in 2021. Okay? So let's talk about modeling capabilities. And we split things more or less in five categories: dams and spillways, conveyance, infrastructure, river and environmental, water treatment, and ports and coastal. Those are kind of the areas of application where we operate the most in the civil water realm. And I'm just going to give you a couple of, just a couple of slides on these different areas. Dams and spillways, a long history with government regulators, hydropower utilities, engineering consultants, hydraulic labs, CFD consultants, academia, all sorts of interesting applications there. Spillways, of course, so rating curves, but a lot of other things as well: jet deflection, spillway water profiles, fish passage hydraulics, forces, scour, head loss or energy dissipation, a wide range of application and a wide range of flow conditions. So it could be open channel, it could be pressurized, it could also be mixed open channel pressurized. That all fits under the same kind of umbrella. It could be a wide range of models that are used, but potentially could be air entrainment, could be all sorts of things. What you know we've seen over the years is that the solution we have for you is a kind of combination of being versatile, robust, accurate, and computationally efficient. That's always what we are looking to achieve. So a few words there on dams and spillways. Conveyance infrastructure, so things like tunnels, overflows, hydraulic controls, any type of hydraulic control, drop structures, a lot of work with drop structures, flow splitting, open channel, conveyance, pumps, flap gates. We can do those with moving objects, airflow, air supply problems, and entrained air. So all under the umbrella of conveyance system, I think combined sewer overflows and all that. And what do you get out of it? Well, as with any CFD simulation, what do you get? Very useful information from an engineering standpoint. So pressure, velocity field, water elevation. This is a completely 3D transient solution. So you have that whole dynamic as well that could be of interest: surges, sloshing, pumps, pump discharge and operations, air phase and trained air, and then forces, again, coupled with moving objects. So all that's a part of the kind of standard output that you get from a simulation. An example here of a drop shaft. So on the left, a very nice project a few years ago from AECOM using FLOW-3D for a tangential drop shaft. And then on the right, a kind of generic simulation there, where what you are seeing in color there is some air is air entrainment, concentration of air. So that's an example of what these simulations look like when you actually run it and post-process. All right. In rivers and environmental, think of, so river hydraulics, inundations, that's one class of problems. More local, bridge hydraulics, also more local sediment and scour. With rivers, when we have power plants, sometimes we have thermal plumes, density flows, we have effluents, pollutions, and those sorts of things. We have intakes and outfalls, and then also some detailed hydraulic controls with culverts, small dams, and weirs. So those are the kind of things you find under the river and environmental umbrella. Just a few examples there. Top left is a kind of energy dissipating culverts. Bang in the middle is a thermal plume. Top right is an overland spill. Bottom left is a shallow water based. It's a larger scale, so we use a shallow water approach for an inundation. And bottom right is a detail of just a small part of a river looking at white water. And the detail of there's some underlying structures there buried under the water, how they affect the local flow, low head kind of hydraulic jumps, submerged jumps, and those sorts of things. So all of this part of what you would do with hydro. And also in Hydra, a very powerful sediment and scour model. So in this case, we are looking at the full two-way coupling between a mobile sediment bed and the dynamic hydraulic field, which affects the scour, and in turn the scour hole will affect the hydraulics. So it's completely coupled, it's a two-way system, and that's a big application. So I should mention tailings. That's actually a new model that's been released in Hydro, and I'll say a few words about it. We are going to have a much more in-depth technical webinar on this topic, either in January, possibly in February. So we'll go to much more detail then. But what this model does, and it, arguably it could be in the dam section, it could also be in the environmental section, either way, I put it here. So what this is a new model, and it allows you to model tailings really in a lot of detail using multi-layered, multi-composition definitions of your tailings. Herschel-Bulkley is used for viscosity definitions, and it's in fact an expanded version of Herschel-Bulkley, which allows you to define your Herschel-Bulkley coefficients as a function of fine tailing concentration. So it's a very, very powerful model in terms of how viscosity is defined for layered regions. It's also what we call a bimodal treatment of fine and coarse tailings, with fine and coarse tailings well behaving differently, and with settling and viscosity modulation options depending on what you have. So I'll show you a bit more of this in just a moment. And then this can be used as a shallow water model, can be used as a 3D model, can also be used as a hybrid shallow water 3D. So sometimes you will use a 3D solution for the kind of immediate vicinity of your breach, and then you'll use a shallow water model for the kind of routing of the flood wave on the larger scales. So full length technical webinar, spring 2021, hoping we can do this late January, early February. So stay tuned, and we'll send out an announcement. So as with most Flow-3D models, they exist in the physics tab in Flow-3D, and you can see here we have this tailing model that we can activate. So let's start with a 3D solution. It's the most physics-based, I suppose, but it's computationally not always suitable for large spatial scales. If it's too large, well, it's just too intense computationally. So there's not always the option to use a 3D solution, and that's why sometimes we use, or often in fact, we use shallow water solutions. But if there's that luxury there, what you can look at is the great detail for, let's say, the first kilometer of a breach, and that can be very interesting. Model includes the full detail of layer composition and rheology, and the Herschel-Bulkley coefficients, like I mentioned, are defined as a function of fine, or can be defined. They can be constant, but they can also be defined as a function of fine particle solid content. And then again, this bimodal definition, we differentiate between fine and coarse particles. So if you just think of, if you're familiar with Flow-3D or Flow-3D Hydro, we have fluid regions. So in this case, there's an example. It's one of the examples that's in Hydro. We have a water region, a fine tailings region, and then another region, another layer, which has fine and coarse tailing. And that kind of represents something very simple like this. We have just three layers, kind of orange, yellow, and red. And this is interesting because it gives you really a lot of detail in how you're defining your region of fluid. So then, we have these Herschel-Bulkley indices that we will define. I'm not going to give you the detail right now. We activate potentially, we don't have to. There's a lot of kind of levels of sophistication that you can deploy or decide not to deploy when you run these models. But in this case, we have coarse particles, fine particles, and then you see we have three fluid regions there. Well, the water has no particles, so tailing concentration 0 and 0. The second region had only fine particles, and then the third region had a mixture of coarse and fine particles. So there's an example in Flow-3D, and when you open Flow-3D Hydro, when you open, you can load an example, tailings dam breach, And what you'll see if you open this model is, in fact, this model that I just showed you. If you actually run the model, in this case we are starting with a fluid region, which has three regions, like we just saw. The tailings, what you see here is a volume fraction. So the kind of dark layer at the very top there is pure water. And then we have those two other regions that we just talked about, and you let this breach, and you are going to have a fully three-dimensional representation of what's happening with this flow in a completely, you know, non-Newtonian fashion. So that's one example, tailings volume fraction. You can look at the same data with, you know, density, you know, also same idea. This is SI units, dynamic viscosity. You can look at all sorts of things, of course, as you examine these results. So it's really a very sophisticated and a very powerful model that we've introduced in this release. So sometimes we can't do a full 3D. Sometimes we don't need the full complexity of, you know, different layers, etc. So we have a 3D homogeneous material. In this case, it's quite simply just a constant coefficient Herschel-Berkeley model. Just wanted to show you that it doesn't necessarily have to be incredibly complicated. It can also be fairly straightforward. You have your Herschel-Berkeley, so your rheology, your consistency, your flow index, and your yield stress, enter those numbers that you have from some kind of rheological test, and then you know, go to work. And this is an example from a case study that we did based on a PhD. We'll be talking about this more in the spring, but just so you see clearly, this is not behaving like water. It's just not. It's a different type of fluid. So this validates extremely well, interesting model here. Okay, now for larger scales, you can't use really 3D solutions, so you will switch to shallow water solutions suitable for larger scales. And then what's happening here is you have your tailings model activated, and you're going to add a shallow water model. And when you activate the shallow water model, then what you need to do is, in fact, activate the two-layer Herschel-Berkeley model, and go to work, set up your simulation. And then this is an example of the validation. So we will talk about this one also a lot more in our technical presentation on the topic, but I just wanted to show you some results. By and large, it's excellent agreement between what was observed in the real world and what was modeled using FLOW-3D Hydro. Okay, so this is an exciting model. Plenty of work still to be done in terms of, it's a very new model, so of course we have to continue working with engineers within the practice and continue exploring all the different features that are available to the modeler. Okay, so moving on, water treatment. Let's see what we have. Well, contact tanks, anything within the wastewater recovery facility. So contact tanks, you know, and chemistry, clarifiers, grit removal, aeration tanks, static mixers. I mentioned in version 2 we'd be focusing a lot more on water treatment. What you can look forward to in version 2 next year will be an activated sludge model, completely coupled, full 3D CFD. So a whole set of equations, I can't remember, 13 or so, dynamically coupled with the CFD. Also models on gas dissolution, oxygen, those sorts of things. So it's really interesting topics for water treatment, and we're going to be talking a lot more about this in 2021. So just a few examples there. Bottom left, some sludge settling, hindered settling, I should say. Top left, clarifier. Middle top, a static mixer. On the right, some particle separation using a hydro cyclone, and then in the middle, on the bottom there, chemistry contact tanks type thing. So a lot of different things you can do. Pretty much all processes within the wastewater treatment plants can benefit from some level of CFD modeling. So something we'll be talking about more. And then finally, ports and coastals, a few examples there. So shallow water modeling, of course, regional scales, breakwaters, coastal structures, outfalls, wave energy conversion. Maybe that's not strictly ports and coastal, but it's happening on the coast, I suppose, ship locks and ship launch. So that's something, a few examples here, of waves, of course, moving objects, completely critical to a lot of the work we do, and the interaction between waves and structures. Okay, so catenaries, fixed structures, floating structures, etc. All of that is part of the work we do in this area. Okay, so let's talk about the user interface. New topic here. So what we did, WYSIWYG, what you see is what you need. A streamlined user interface with workflows designed for civil and environmental industry applications. So we'll talk about that. We'll talk about template workspaces. That's really a very new thing that does not exist in Flow-3D, and it's really kind of at the core of how we do things in Hydro. Also, I'll talk about a library of prepackaged examples, come in very handy, and expanded video tutorials that's actually being phased or released beginning 2021. So let's take a look at WYSIWYG. What you see is what you need, and what we've done is just removed all the non-water models. And by non-water, I mean models that you will truly never need as a water engineer in the civil practice. You know, electromagnetism is not something you need, so it's not there. It's just clutters your interface, and you don't need it. So this delivers improved clarity and also more immediate access to what you need. So why is this important? Well, superior modeling clarity yields a more sequential workflow. It also means fewer places to make mistakes and better visibility into important settings. Take that all together, and what you will get are better modeling outcomes. Okay, so that's important. I don't want to spend too much time on that, but it's important that clarifying things is actually a benefit. It's not taking things away. We're not taking anything away that you'll ever need in Hydro and civil. But in fact, we are in fact improving the clarity of what you're looking at, and that in turn has benefits for you as a modeler. It's important to recognize that. The template workspaces. So let's take a look at that. So we have multiple templates, workspace templates. Free surface, TrueVof is the default. We have a lot of that. A lot of hydraulic problems are just that, free surface problems. We also have air entrainment templates, thermal plumes, sediment transport, shallow water, a whole range that you can choose from. And let me just give you a few examples. So what happens is when you open a new simulation, well, you'll choose a template that you want to work from. So something like this would be fairly typical of a free surface problem. What you would do, you would just use the free surface TrueVof template. If you're looking at a case, let's say we're looking at the onset of aeration, self-aeration on a stepped chute. That's not just hydraulics. You just have to look at it and you realize, well, it's not just hydraulics. There's also air entrainment. You can see very clearly there around step 6, 7, 8 there, awful lot of air entrainment going on. Well, probably you'll need more than just a hydraulics model to kind of get an accurate idea of what's going on with this structure. So the air entrainment template comes into play there. Thermal plumes, just a very kind of specific way of modeling things sometimes, so that's kind of warranted its own templates. Sediment transport is also something that has some fairly specific settings that are application specific, so that also warranted its own template. We have a shallow water template and then a two fluid VOF template, that example that I had shown you before, where you're actually modeling both the water and the air as opposed to just modeling the water. And then finally, for internal flows, no free surface. So something like a static mix or any structure where you know that there is no free surface, the flow is entirely pressurized, entirely confined. Well, in that case, you don't need to ask the solver to spend the extra computational resources computing the free surface. You just don't need it. So in that case, you can use a no free surface template. So looking at this in a bit more detail, all appropriate settings for common free surface hydraulic models have been preloaded. That's really nice. So what does it look like? So we'll start with your global settings. So reference pressure will be atmospheric pressure. We'll use gauge pressure. That's generally what we use for our models. We'll preload, of course, gravity and viscosity. That's our physics models. We'll preload water, fluid one. We will also preload the kind of the outputs that you will generally need for these types of simulations. So we aren't taking away anything in terms of your ability to, you know, model with specific types of parameters, or and you know, we're not taking away any choices, but we are preloading a lot of things for you so that you don't have to do it yourself every time you set up a model. Now the numerics as well, same idea. There remain a few key steps for the user. So loading your geometry, that's up to you. Applying a computational mesh around your geometry, that's up to you. And boundary conditions and initial conditions, that's also up to you. But by and large, the other steps, we have done a lot of the kind of homework for you. And in this case, maybe it looks fairly simple, but in other cases, we've actually set up some things for you which truly help you get started quickly, and I'll show you what that looks like in just a minute. And note that even for the geometry, the meshing, the boundaries, and the initial conditions, we've even in those tabs, we've also preloaded common defaults, which will help you kind of get through things faster when you set up your model. So if you're modeling water, on Earth, the free surface TrueVolv template is always a great starting point. There's no question there. Okay, so let's look at the air entrainment. So what happens in this case? Well, let's say you have agitated flow, and entrained air could be important. Bulking could be important. Maybe dissolved oxygen could be important. All sorts of reason why you would try and want to characterize what's happening with the interaction of air being entrained in the water. In that case, you would choose the air entrainment template and just make that choice, click OK. And what's going to happen now is we've activated some physics for you. We've activated the air entrainment model, but hand in hand with that model, if you want to capture kind of the rise of the bubbles in the water column, well, in that case, you need to activate a dispersed multi-phase flow model. So we've activated that for you. You will need also a certain type of variable density. We've activated that option for you as well. So let's take a look at these air entrainment. Okay, we've set basically the right settings for you, assuming you are working with water and air. The dispersed multi-phase flow, we've also kind of preloaded, you know, the settings that would be applicable for civil engineering applications. There's variable density flow needs to be activated. We've done that for you, and we've also chosen, there's four choices there. Well, which one is the one that you need for this type of application? So you can open the model or the manual, you can go to help, you can call support, but if you're using a template, well, we've actually told you what you need to do, and so you don't have to think about it too much. Although it's always good to keep a critical eye, of course, what you're doing with your modeling. Okay, and then your pre-selected outputs, like with everything else. Now, sometimes you build off a template in order to add a new dimension. So sometimes air entrainment is also associated with subatmospheric conditions. If you think, for instance, of the priming of a siphon, that's exactly how that works. So you might start with an air entrainment model and then, well, realize, well, I need to add something else in order to capture the subatmospheric, the depressurization of a void area, like you have in a siphon or in a tunnel, potentially. So we would add a model. This particular one is called the dynamic void pressure. You activate this model, and there you go. You then continue working towards a more and more sophisticated solution. So what this does, just for your information, it allows pressure to change on the air side. Even though you're doing a one fluid valve, it allows pressure to be computed on the air side as a uniform pressure, but a varying pressure. So this allows you to basically model removal of air and the consequence on pressure in your system. Okay, so, and again, we'll preload what you need for civil applications right there. So as an example, just what you know, an air entrainment model might look like. This is a weir with a very, very labyrinth weir with a very, very energetic flow downstream. You can see it's a complex flow. And what we are looking at here in the dark blue is the concentration of air. So very interesting. Generally, the topic is extremely interesting, but we have a template for it as well. So you too, if you'd like to get started and explore this model, go for it. Okay, so thermal plume, that's also an interesting topic. And this one, is the template is extremely useful because some of the settings are not completely obvious. What we activate, thermal flow, gravity, turbulence, variable density, fine. So in this case, it's a different type of computation of density. So we've chosen the relevant one for thermal plumes. Also included volumetric thermal expansion. Let's see, we've activated heat transfer. That's one thing. We've activated the turbulence model. But something that's fairly unique to thermal flows is the coefficient of buoyancy in turbulent production. So that's normally set to zero for almost all flows, except when you have a buoyant flow in this case. And you might not know this unless you've really paid a very close attention to the manual help, or if you've attended one of my colleague Brian Fox's webinars. He also a technical webinar, he points that out. But it's very easy to forget that. But that's the beauty of a template. Is that, in fact, we've remembered for you. Okay, also the fluids. So we've preloaded temperature as a function of, or density as a function of temperature and so on. All that's very, very useful when you want to just get quickly to a running model. In this case, a thermal plume. And then we've also activated the defaults for your output that you're we assume you're going to be interested in particular density and the temperature of the fluid. Okay, sediment transport. So you're getting the idea. I'm just showing you a little bit what's left here. We have sediment transport. You're going to activate the sediment transport physics, preload or predefine a good number of defaults there that are generally very effective for these types of solutions. But you're still in full control of what you are doing. So we're not restraining you. Again, density here is evaluated as a function of other quantities and what this looks like when you actually look, as mentioning earlier, the coupling between the flow and the scour and the change, the deformation of the bed and how it affects the hydraulics. So it's a bit of an old example, but it's very telling, shows you what's going on with this process. Okay. Then shallow water, same idea. You activate the shallow water model, etc., and so on. So, two fluid simulations. A bit. This one also is a very useful template because it preloads some of the things that you need. So we'll choose the two fluid VAF. Technically, the only thing you really need is gravity, turbulence, and variable density flow. Of course, you have to specify that you have two fluids. The dispersed multiphase flow is actually a very good setting for air entrainment because it also includes the drift flux of air bubbles. If they've been, for whatever reason, entrained into the fluid, it allows those bubbles to rise up to the surface. So it's a more complete characterization of what's actually going on. So we usually activate dispersed multiphase flow as well when we do two fluid simulations. Okay, so you have your density, your multiphase, dispersed multiphase flow settings. Your fluid 2, of course, has to be loaded. So we have fluid 1 is water, fluid 2 is air. All of this is preloaded for you, so you don't have to do all these steps manually if you're doing a two fluid model. We've done it all for you. And then finally, free surface. The real change there is in the interface tracking, where you would select no sharp interface. All right. So just generally what happens, you start a new simulation. Step 1, you'll choose your template workspace, import your CAD, set your mesh, set your initial and boundary conditions. If needed, make modifications to the setup, and finally run and post-process. So that's the kind of workflow that we hope you can adopt and be very efficient in setting up your simulations and just not forgetting things. So for now, we have these workspaces. We are working towards updating or adding new workspaces. Tailings is one which will benefit a lot. So we're hoping to add this in the near future. And also water treatment topics in general would benefit from these template workspaces and then moving objects as well. So that's where we are with workspaces. I'll talk a little bit about examples. So in workspace, sometimes it just doesn't really help you for what you're trying to do. So for instance, in either of these two simulations, we have a buoy that's being moved along by a wave train. There's a catenary holding it in place, or below that we have a contact tank with some chemistry going on. Well, so far what you've seen, the templates won't help you set this up very much. So we have an additional resource, which gives you a second kind of helping point, reference point, and those are examples. So these are also continuously updated. At the moment we have over 30. I can't remember exactly, but it's over 30 and less than 40. So that's full detailed examples. There's a whole bunch of them. And what they do is, well, we have details of how we've set up models, and you can look through and try to find some help for to kind of mirror this or use this to help you set up your own problem. So there's a whole variety of examples. So you have a detailed starting point for most applications. So if you go back to our two problems there that we were wondering how to model, well, we can look through the list. And well, there's one on a wave energy converter that's not too different. It has a moving object, it has a wave train, so you'll probably be able to get some good information there. It is missing the catenary, but if I look a bit more down the list, in fact there is one called a floating structure, which will give you pretty much all the settings you need for your application on the left, so you can use that as a starting point. And then in fact, as it turns out, for a contact tank, there's something that's almost a replica of what I was trying to simulate. Well, it's different geometry, different flow rate, etc., different reaction coefficients for the kinetics and the chemical reaction, but nonetheless, basically everything's in place. So I can take that and then adapt it to my own problem. That's the idea there. Okay, so that's two ways of helping you. Well, three ways, I should say. WYSIWYN, in and of itself, that's a very useful advance in the way we do things in Hydro. The workspaces, the templates are extremely useful. And then the examples are also extremely useful. And then finally, video tutorials. These are not out just yet, but it will be very shortly. And these are basically A to Z, A to Z, step-by-step recording for a wide range of applications. So these provide how-to information, really, you know, a modeler recording exactly what they are doing. So you won't miss anything. Just follow the guide and you should be able to understand how to set up a whole range of applications. Okay, so these are also an excellent route to quickly learning how to model a wide variety of applications. So that's for the interface. And then a couple more items that I just wanted to mention. Well, Hydro, a lot of our users actually run Flow-3D on the cloud because it's just incredibly powerful to run on 80 cores, 120 cores. Things run much faster. So Flow-3D Hydro is available right now as we speak. It's on cloud. If you open your cloud account, you should be able to see Hydro. And if you'd like a demo, if you don't use cloud, or if you don't use Hydro, or if you don't use Flow-3D, in all cases, we are happy to demo how this all works. And just to give you an idea there, a lot of the work that's done on in engineering offices is done on workstations. So those may go up to 40, maybe 56, maybe more even. That's one solver architecture, if you like. And then once we get to a cluster solution, we go to high-performance computing solutions. And so workstations kind of increase in performance until they kind of level out a little bit as they get into the higher core counts. And then things pick up again once you switch to a high-performance computing framework. In particular, the 80 for a lot of water problems, 80 cores, 120 cores, 160 cores are really nice sweet spots in terms of performance and cost. and running problems with the 50 million cells, 100 million cells, all of that is completely in reach once you kind of transition to using, let's say, 80 cores. You can do a lot with that right there. Okay, so that was my notes on cloud. And if I summarize things a little bit here, what we've done here, what we've tried to do in this particular version of Hydro V1.0, so the tailings model is truly a new development. We've increased vastly improved the performance of the two-fluid model in this release. But those are developments kind of things. In terms of work environments, what we've tried to do here, and I've summarized this, is give you the templates, help you with model selection, everything we've talked about, the examples, and the video tutorials, and the WYSIWYG user interface. Those are all kind of components that should help you be very successful with your modeling first time around without having to go dig in a manual in the help email support. You should be able to find all the information you need at your fingertips using these resources. In addition, for large models, by all means, go and run things on cloud. It's very, very efficient. And then, of course, at the core of our entire business model is our support. So live help with expert modelers who work in the specifically in civil engineering, so water resource engineers, model review, troubleshooting, help with cloud, etc. We are always really happy to talk to you and kind of see what you are doing, and if we can help, happy to help. All right, so the take-home message. Hydro is builds on industry leading free surface modeling technology, that's the FLOW-3D engine, as it were, to deliver state-of-the-art CFD modeling for water civil applications, truly unprecedented ease of use, and exceptional support every step of your modeling journey through all these different dimensions that I've spoken about. And then also, I just want to reiterate here, a continued commitment to developing advanced solver capabilities for the water and civil and environmental industry. So I went through a lot. I've used up the full hour, I think. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for registering. Thank you for your interest. Any questions? As I said, find your local associate. That's probably the best first step. But in all cases, you can always email us at hydro@flow3d.com, and we look forward to hearing about your applications, and if we can help you, all the better. Okay, thank you, and until next time.